Thank you very much, Michael. I'm greatly honored by this invitation to participate in this conference being organized by Jindal Global University. The subject of our panel is corporate governance, competition, and regulation. So what I'll try to do very briefly is to weave together these three concepts or these three issues, how they interface with each other, but mainly coming from the perspective of competition law, which has been my background for several years now. And in order to appreciate the role and position of competition law in our economy today, it's important to understand how it originated, how we sort of transited from the MRTPC regime, which was an anti-monopoly, anti-big legislation, into a modern competition law. And you have to see it in the context of the economic liberalization which we undertook in the early 90s. As you know, for several years we followed a command and control regime. Many of you would not have been born at that time. And for some time it served a useful purpose in India. But later on it became, we realized that this is acting now more as an obstacle to growth, as an obstacle to the entrepreneurial spirit and energies rather than, and therefore it is condemning us to a late rate of growth, often referred to as the Hindu rate of growth. And in 1991, we found itself in a very, very critical situation when we had barely about 2 weeks of foreign currency reserves. So there was a big bang transition to break down the economic controls and free the economy to grow on in a market-based manner. So wide-ranging reforms were undertaken across the board, whether these were industrial licensing, whether it was foreign currency, whether it was banking and interest rates, whether it was import and export controls, and so on and so forth. And one of the changes which was made at that time was to look at the existing MRTP Act, the Monopolies and Restricted Trade Practices Act. And it was realized that this was actually working not like a competition authority, but it was working more like an arm in the command and control regime of government. And therefore, there was a surgery performed on the MRTP Act, and certain portions of the Act relating to controls on large enterprises were simply removed from that Act. But down the line, it was realized that merely tinkering with an existing legislation is not going to bring about the kind of competition law which prevails in the more mature jurisdictions. And therefore, an exercise was launched for bringing in a new competition law, and finally this came in January 2003. We had a completely new competition law. This law is not old wine in a new bottle, both in terms of the philosophy and the economic principles which run through this law, as well as in the detailed provisions of the law. It is starkly different from the erstwhile MRTP Act. So this new law basically was a recognition of the fact that we now are moving to a market-based economy whereby government controls have been removed. Certain government oversight also, which used to prevail by way of price control on sensitive items, whether it was food grains or whether it was cement or steel, etc., etc., these were being removed. But you need a certain body, oversight body, to still keep a benign watch over the markets. It was realized that competition definitely is now something which we have to allow because of the various economic benefits which it brings to society. What are those benefits? Competition ensures a higher level of efficiency. When enterprises fight against each other, they tend to be more efficient, unlike a monopoly, which tends to be more complacent. It leads to greater efficiency. Newer and newer products and services are invented, and they reach the consumer, and thereby provide to the consumer a better choice, a wider choice, greater availability of goods at more reasonable and affordable prices. And you can see that in the last several years, wherever competition has been allowed to prevail, what a transformation has taken place. Whether you see telecommunications, whether you look at cars, whether you look at electronic and consumer goods or white goods, what a transformation has taken place in the Indian society. Now, in order to ensure that you have competition within the economy, in the markets, two things are required. One is a pro-competition policy framework, and the other is a competition law. The policy framework ensures that in the government policy making, it is not administrative controls or discretion which is going to decide who gets to make what, but the forces of competition will decide who gets to do what. So government policy making should allow greater space for the competition forces and not make judgments on what to make, how many cars to make, what a quantity of steel should be produced by the Steel Authority of India or by Tata Steel, and at what price should they be selling it. So these decisions should not be allowed in the marketplace. And the second thing is that once you say that competition is free, is going to be free between enterprises, you need a watchdog to make sure that the principles of competition are not violated. To make sure that now, unlike earlier by government or by government-owned companies, now private companies are not doing things which are going to undermine competition. And that you can do that only by having a competition law. So that is the role of the new competition law, to make sure that enterprises, while they are competing freely, they do not do certain things which are going to undermine competition in the markets. And to do that, the role of the Competition Commission is vastly different from that of any regulator. And now here I've come to this little interface between competition and regulation. The regulator, like the stock market regulator, SEBI, like the telecom regulator, TRAI, they are in-market regulators. They sit in the market and they take micro decisions about how to control the market. Whereas the Competition Commission is an off-market authority. It doesn't sit within the market. It has no authority whatever to tell any enterprise what to do, how much to produce, what price to sell, etc., whom to appoint as a distributor. It sits outside the market very much like a referee or like the umpire. The players are free to play as vigorously, as aggressively as you, for example, see in the India-Australia ODIs when they happen. They are free to ball in any way, to bat in any way. The umpire cannot tell them what to do and what not to do. Only they have to observe certain rules and they cannot violate those rules. For example, you cannot bowl more than one bumper in an over, or that in the first few overs you cannot have more than a certain number of fielders sitting outside the circle. So you can only bowl six balls in an over. You cannot do a no ball, you cannot cross the line. So they can only, the Competition Commission, like a referee or an umpire, sits outside and keeps a watchful eye that these fundamental rules of competition are not in any way violated by the players. That's the role of the Competition Authority. On the other hand, the regulator provides detailed rules. SEBI tells you that if you want to make a public offer for shares, what is it that you must disclose, how you are going to price the share, How will you make sure that the retail investors get a certain amount of a certain share of a certain portion of the share issue, and so on and so forth? If you want to take over another enterprise, what are the rules that you must observe when you are doing that takeover or acquisition? So unlike that, the Competition Commission doesn't say anything at all. But even in the regulated sectors, apart from the regulator, it sits there, is there like a cloud, constantly present but not invading the market. So even if in the regulated sector, for example, in telecom, if the telecom companies are forming a cartel and thereby deciding their pricing, the Competition Commission is allowed to step in and punish the cartel. So it is an ever-present kind of thing, but it's virtually like in a regulated sector, it is the second line of regulation. So what is it that this Competition Act allows you to do or not to do? The Competition Act doesn't tell you what you can do. The Competition Act only tells you that here are a few rules which you should not be breaking. And what are those rules? One set of rules relate to agreements. When there are agreements between enterprises, what kind of agreements are prohibited? Any agreement which has a significant anti-competitive effect is prohibited. So if there is an agreement between competitors that we will price cement at 250 rupees a bag, or we will now increase the price of steel by 1,000 rupees a ton, any such agreement is prohibited by the, is a serious violation of the Act. Similarly, there may be vertical agreements between a manufacturer and a distributor and a retailer. And if this vertical agreement also contains something which is anti-competitive, then again it is prohibited. For example, if the manufacturer tells a distributor that you are distributor only for this area, for Haryana, the other distributor is there only for Punjab. Okay, that much is okay. But if you tell this distributor that if a customer from Punjab comes to you and wants to buy your Tata car, your Nano car, you will not sell it to him. And you will tell him to go back and buy only from the Punjab distributor. Now that is an unreasonable restriction, and that will be prohibited. The other set of prohibitions relates to very big, dominant companies. Not big in terms of size, but big in terms of the market share and the economic power that they enjoy. So certain companies may be dominant in the market in the sense that they have virtually no competition. So Reliance Industries has, say, about 85% of the market share in certain petrochemicals. Now, it has grown to this size, it has grown to this market share by virtue of its superior efficiency, by virtue of better service, by better or greater innovation. All that is perfectly permitted. The Competition Act cannot stop you from going larger and larger, more and more market share. It cannot stop you. But the way in which you acquire this dominance, or once becoming dominant, the way you use your dominant position or abuse your dominant position, that is prohibited by the Competition Act. So if you are a dominant company and you do predatory pricing, that means you sell your goods below cost so that the weaker competitors would get wiped out meanwhile.